Wants to leave the torrent, such IP addresses should be removed from the tracker's list, right? Why? Because that peer will not be existing anymore in the torrent. So if any peer wants to leave the torrent, first contact the tracker, and from the tracker the IP address should be removed, and that's how the peer will leave the torrent. And one more thing should happen there, tracker should do that. If any peer leaves the torrent, see here, for this peer, neighbors, peer has three neighbors. For this peer, this peer is a neighbor, this peer is a neighbor, and one more, this peer is a neighbor. So these three neighbors also should be updated that the peer is going to leave, right? So here, every peer has its neighbor information. That is one more thing that you have to remember. Alice here will be knowing about this peer, again this peer, and this peer. What exactly she'll be knowing? She'll be knowing about all the list of files that these peers has. That list of files is shared by these peers to Alice, right? So those list of files will be existing with Alice. So that information what Alice has is required for her to communicate with them, correct? To download the contents. That list of files is very much important. So if any peer here wants to leave the torrent, suppose this peer wants to leave the torrent, in that case, his IP address should be removed from the tracker. At the same time, tracker also should notify Alice and the other neighbor of this peer. Who is the other neighbor? This peer here. This neighbor also should be notified that this peer is going to leave the torrent, and all the files that this peer has also will not be existing anymore. So those list of files what Alice has also should be now removed, correct? So the list of file what this peer has shared with Alice, that list of files is no more existing. Why? Because this peer is going to leave the torrent. So that job is also done by tracker. Okay, so remember, so any peer here can leave the torrent, or any peer can join the torrent. So this leaving and joining, that concept you call it as churn, peer churn. So peer churn is what? Leaving or joining the torrent. Okay, so remember this concept. Yeah, so as I have already explained this, requesting the chunk, how the requesting happens, and how exactly the sharing of chunk, the meaning of chunk is nothing but you are exchanging the files in the form of different small piece of data. Say suppose if I have a file of 1 GB, that 1 GB file will be broken into multiple chunks, and you can say that each chunk of data, say containing 256 bits or something, 256 bytes or something. Okay, so if I have a file of 1 GB, I can break up that 1 GB file into multiple small pieces, and each such piece you call it as a chunk, okay, of particular size. So sharing of file is happening in the form of chunks here. And I explained this optimistically unchoked peer. So for Alice, one randomly chosen peer is there, and that randomly chosen peer you call as Bob. So Alice will randomly choose one peer called Bob, and that for that randomly chosen Bob, Alice will start uploading the content. So this Bob has become optimistically unchoked peer. Okay, so sharing is happening now two way, because for Bob, one point of time Alice becomes top uploader, so Bob also will start sending the data back to Alice. Okay, so this is all happening. Yeah, so I hope this torrent concept is clear. Yes, let's move on to the next concept of distributed hash table. So what is this distributed hash table basically? It's a continuation over here. Yeah, so I'll just start with this distributed hash table. Okay, so first of all here, in the peer-to-peer network, or say let's take an example of our torrent itself. In the torrent, when Alice wants to download one particular file, whether Alice will be knowing which peer exactly in the torrent has that file. Say, I said already, I gave you an example here in the torrent, that let's take a torrent. Yeah, in this torrent, see, Alice wants to download a file. Let me take now a different example, not movie. Alice wants to download a file named Computer Networks or CN. Alice wants to download a file named CN. So Alice, what she knows, she just knows the name of the file. She doesn't know which peer in this network has a copy of the file named CN. Correct? Maybe one or more than one peer in this torrent has the file named named CN. But Alice doesn't know that. In order to do that, in order to find out which peer has exactly the file CN, what Alice has to do now? One easiest way is Alice should send the request, and the request should contain the file name. So this requested file CN, that request should be sent to all the peers in the torrent. Yes or no? That is the easiest way. What Alice should do now, she should send the request, and the request should contain the file name, and here the file name is what? CN. And that request, she doesn't know which peer she has to ask, right? So she will stand on the hilltop and she will scream now, saying that who has the file CN. So when she is screaming, everybody will hear that, right? When everybody hears this request, at least some peers will raise their hand and say, yes, we have this files CN. One who has this peers, one the peers which has exactly this file CN, at least those peers will respond saying that, yes, we have this file CN, right? So that the same procedure is followed here. What is that? Alice will request, send the request, or you call this as broadcasting. She will broadcast the request to all the peers here in the torrent. Now, which peers will start responding? Only those peers which actually has the copy of this file CN will start responding back to Alice, saying that, yes, we have the file named CN. But tell me, practically, this broadcasting, is it possible? Here, this is a small torrent which contains only 8 peers or so. But practically, the peer or the torrent will contain, practically, this torrent may have millions of peers. So whether it is possible for Alice or anybody to broadcast the request to millions of peers, not possible, right? So broadcasting is a bad way. So is there any other way wherein we can search for the requesting file, search for the file, so that I can start downloading the file? Yes. So the other way of searching for the file is this distributed hash table. So what is that happening here? See, one small database will be developed. One small database will be developed here in the torrent. In our torrent, you have basically many peers, right? So here we will develop one, what is that database? And that database will contain two columns. And what is that two columns? Two information. One is key information, the other one is value information. You just see this example. This is one small database, or you can say this is one small table which has key and value pairs. You can see here, I have different files, file names, in my first column, and I call that as key. First file name is DBMS, next file name is ME, next is .NET, next CN, next Python, next you may have some more, and the last one I will call it as OS. These are different file names, and you can see the value here associated with this. What are these values indicating? Whether it looks like the IP address is here? Yes, it is the IP address. Okay, so you have here IP address 198.168.101.0. This is the system's IP address which actually has the file called DBMS. You can see here it is this system whose IP address is 101.0. It is this system which actually owns the file DBMS. Similarly, the next system with IP address .1, it's a different system which has the file ME. The next system again you have with IP address 2 here which has the file .NET. Again, you have one more system with IP address .3. See, so here you can see how many systems? 3, 4, 5, and you may have some more. Okay, and 6. Total 6 systems we have. 6 different systems, 6 different peers, which actually has the 6 different files stored in it, right? But this information is the one which we are looking for. So Alice here wants to know, Alice wants to download the file named CN, correct? Now, where her request should reach actually, looking at this table, you will come to know where her request should reach. See, her request should reach exactly this system with IP address 198.168.101.3. And once it reaches this system, she can easily download the file CN. Why? Because the copy of CN is available only in this particular system. But how will Alice know that this particular system, that is with IP address 101.3, has this file CN? Yes, it is happening through this database. Alice should first get this particular database. Once she gets this database, she can easily search for the entry. So how will she search in this database? With the help of file name or with the help of key here, she will search in the database. And here the fourth row in the database will match with the entry, will match with the requested file name CN. And this fourth entry, fourth row is extracted. And what is that we are looking for? We are looking for the value part. We are looking for the IP address. Once this IP address is obtained by Alice, now she can develop the TCP connection with this remote IP address, with this remote system. And then her data exchange, her file downloading can happen in the next stage, right? But now you just see this table. So what is that? First file name is there and the next file is IP address. Okay. And now the next thing is, can we make this still more simpler? Rather than matching file name here, or rather than maintaining file name in my database, can I make the search still more simpler? See, searching is happening through what? Pattern matching here. My file name should be matched with the key value here. Pattern matching should happen, or alphabets should be matched, right? So that's how my matching will do. That's how the search procedure will continue. So can I make my search still more simpler? Rather than doing this pattern matching, can I convert this key value, which is an alphabets, to an integer value? Why? Because always searching with the help of an integer is easier compared to searching with the help of alphabets, so comparing with the help of patterns, right? So what will I do in the next stage here is, I will convert my file name. So I'll convert my file name, which was DBMS, ME or .NET. So this will be converted into an integer value. So what integer value I'm going to take here? You just see here. See, how do I do that? I'll tell you. First step is, convert this. See, I'll take an example of DBMS. I'll convert this alphabets, which contains this four alphabets, DBMS, into a decimal, into a binary value. I can do that, yeah. Once I convert it into binary value, how many bit binary? I'll choose the bits. N is equal to 4, correct? If I choose N is equal to 4, number of bits, that is, I'm going to convert this into binary. If I choose the number of bits to 4, then I can generate the key in the range of, see, 0 to 2 to the power N, minus 1. See, this power is only for n, okay? 2 raised to n minus 1. So now tell me, what is the range of keys that I can generate, or how many bits I can have? I'll convert this into binary, and the number of bits in the binary is only 4, correct? So I can have 4 bit binary, convert it into binary. Once I convert it into binary, I'm going to convert it into an integer value. And what is that integer value I can convert it into? That integer value will be in the range 0 2 to the power n minus 1. So what is that range here? N value is equal to 4. So number of binary bits is only 4. So 2 raised to n is how much? 2 raised to 4. So 2 raised to 4 is how much? 16. 16 minus 1 is 15. So the number of integer values that I can have here for 4 bit binary is 0 to 15. So the range is 0 to 15. So what is the meaning of that? I can have here for 4 bit binary, I can have the key values generated from 0 to 15. So that means 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15. Total 15 keys can be generated. For total 15 integer values can be generated for these original keys, for these original values. Okay. See, if I have here DBMS as the first value, I've converted this into the integer value. And what is the corresponding integer value here is, it is 11. How did I get this 11? I said the range is from 0 to 15. But how did I get this value 11? For this, you are going to have a hashing technique. You're going to follow a hashing technique. So what is that hashing technique here? Hash, you have see several techniques to generate this, right? So one such technique is hash. So hash value, I hope you all know it. See, first value, how do you write it? How do you write the hash value? How do you generate it? Using mod operator, correct? You should have an higher limit. Using the mod operator, you get the hash value. So what exactly you are hashing? You are hashing this original key value. So original key here is say DBMS. Hash of DBMS is the key that you are obtaining, and that is 11. So how do you compute this hash? You have very various techniques for that. I can use mod operator to generate the hash value. So using mod operator, I will generate one key. I will generate key by taking hash value of this DBMS. So DBMS is first converted into binary, and that binary value, whatever you get, you convert it into integer, and that integer of that integer take a hash value, and that hash value, whatever you get here, will be within the limit 0 to 15. It should be within the limit 0 to 15 only. You can't have a key greater than 15 here. You can't have a key less than 0. Negative key also you can't have. Your key should be within 0 to 15. So for that, what you have to do here in the hash, you have to take a mod operator and mod, and the upper limit is 16 here. Upper limit should be 16. So any integer you take a mod operator with 16, you get the remainder there between 0 to 15 only, right? So 0 to 15 only, you will get the remainder. So that keys, whatever you get, you enter over here. So DBMS, I have got the hash value 11, ME, I got 8, .NET 7, CN 15, Python 4, OS 13. All these are within the range 0 to 15. No value is greater than 15 here, right? Okay, so once I get this key value that is within 0 to 15, now anymore I'm interested in these key values. Rather than taking this original keys, now I'm going to take this integer values. Okay, so you have seen now our database is little extended. I have three columns in my database. First one is original key, second one is key, and the third one is value. Now my search will proceed with the help of this key. Rather than taking this original key, my search will proceed with the help of this key. We will see how I'm going to utilize this key value for my search. Okay, yes, now we'll see next. See, as I said, this is our database. Now my next question is, where do I store this database? See, Alice wants to search for a file called CN. What she will do? She will request, and her request will have a file name CN. Now what this next step is, the CN file name will be converted into an integer value, and that converted integer value will be considered as one key value. See, for CN, the converted integer value or the key value is 15. With the help of this 15, searching should proceed. So what Alice should do basically, Alice should contact this database first. Alice should first search, take this database, should be getting this database. Now, next question is, where will this database be residing? This database, will it be with Alice? Or will this database be with other peers, some other peers? Yes. One procedure is, you distribute this database among multiple peers in the system. Or if not multiple peers, almost many, all the peers in the torrent should have this database. Practically, is it possible all the peers in the torrent having this database? Not possible, right? So at least you distribute this database among multiple peers in the torrent. So when multiple peer has this particular database with them, then it will be easy for Alice to contact with those peers and search for the required content with this content that she is requesting for or that she is interested with, right? So what Alice should do now, first she should contact a peer, one which has this database. One which has this database, okay, you call this as distributed hash table, and this hash table will be, should be distributed among multiple peers. Now Alice will contact one such system, one such peer which has this database, and after that the request will be taken to that database, and with the help of the integer value, matching takes place. Now, once Alice obtains, now she's looking for Cn, right? The corresponding key value for Cn is 15. Now, once she obtains this, she will be interested, she'll be interested now with what? The IP address. What is this IP address exactly? This IP address is the one which actually has the copy of the file Cn. Now, Alice is interested in this particular IP address, this particular system. Alice now will directly contact the system with IP address 101.3, and with that system, she will develop the TCP connection and she will start downloading the file CN. Okay, yes. Now let's make this still more simpler. Search, let's make this still more simpler. So, what is that still more simpler? All this we have, I have explained. Yes, I'll make it still more simpler. What is it? Yes, as I already said, this entire table should be stored in multiple peers, I said, right? Entire table should be stored in multiple peers, I said. Instead of storing this entire table in multiple peers, can I make it still more simpler? What is that? In my torrent, the torrent containing multiple peers here, say for example, I'll go back to torrent and show you. Say this is a torrent, right? I have multiple peers in here. One Alice is one of the peer, multiple peers you have here. Here also multiple peers are there. Here above is also a peer. There are multiple peers here, correct? Now here, I will assign a unique ID to each of this peer. IP addresses all these peers will have, definitely. Apart from IP address, I will assign unique identifiers to these peers. What identifiers I'm going to assign to these peers? It is the same IDs, whatever I have used here, these IDs. What are these IDs? I have taken the key IDs, right? Hash value I've taken, that is from 0 to 15, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that, till 15. The same IDs I'll be using here to assign to each of these peers. So here, if my torrent contains, in this torrent, I have how many? 1, 2, 3, sorry. In this torrent, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 peers in this torrent, correct? So each of these peers we will be assigning IDs. So what IDs will be assigned? We will see here. I have taken an example. Yes, I have 8 peers in my torrent, and for those 8 peers, we have assigned IDs. What IDs? Apart from IP address, the IDs what we have assigned is from 0 to 15 only, that is. One of the peer is getting the ID 1, the next peer is ID 3, third peer's ID is 4, next peer's ID is 5, next is 8, next is 10, next is 12, and the last one is 15. If I have 8 peers in the torrent, your random IDs are assigned to those 8 peers. Those random IDs are these 1, 3, 4, 5, 8, 10, 12, 15. Now, my next question is, rather than storing this entire table, entire database in all the peers, all these 8 peers, what we will do here is we will assign the key value pairs, each key value pairs only in each of these peers. What is the meaning of key value pair? Instead of all these rows stored in all the tables, all the peers, sorry. Some of the rows, or only one row, or maybe two rows, only we will store in each of the peer. So, how is that storing of key value pair, single key value pair, or two key value pairs only in each peer? So, that is done over here. You see, suppose I want to store a key with ID 11, a key, sorry, suppose if I want to store a row with key value equal to 11. So what is that? A row with key value equal to 11. We'll just go back to our table and see. I want to store this first row with the original key DBMS, file name DBMS. What is the key value of that? 11. So this key value pair, key and value pair, this row I have to store now. Which peer I'm going to store this value? I can store this row, see, remember the key value is 11, right? So this particular row I will store, I can store in its closest successor. So, or I can say in its closest peer. What do you mean by closest peer? What is the integer value closer to 11? Two values are closer to 11. One is 10 and one more is 12. Both IDs are existing here in my peer? Yes. Peer list has the IDs 1, 3, 4, 5, 8, 10, 12 and 15. There are two closer values to 11. One is 10 and the other one is 12. But the standard says that always the key value when you're storing in the peer, you choose a peer with its immediate successor, one which is immediate successor. What is a successor of 11? 12 is a successor of 11. So rather than choosing the predecessor, we will choose the successor. So what is the successor of 11? It's 12. So I'm going to choose among these 8 peers, one peer is chosen, and which peer is that? With the ID 12. Immediate successor of the key, that is 12, I have chosen. And in this peer, among these 8, I've chosen a peer with ID 12. And in this particular peer with ID 12, I'm going to store this key value with the, which is that key? That is the key of DBMS. So that DBMS key is 11, and that I'm going to store in this peer with ID 12. Now, did you understand? Now, the next key I have with the row with the key 13. So, which is that key 13? It is OS, the copy of OS, which is that key 13. This particular key value, this particular row, which peer should have this particular row? Where I'm going to store this key value pair? So 13, for 13, you just see which is the closest successor. Successor of 13, I don't have 14. So I have instead 15. So 15 itself is my immediate successor. So for 13, 15 is a successor. So that key value which is containing OS is a file, OS file. So that I'm going to, that key value pair only I'm going to store in the peer 15. Similarly, if I have a key with 15, I have a key with 15, I guess it is CN. So that particular key value pair where I'm going to just store, I'm not going to search for successor this time. If the key is matching exactly with the peer ID, then no confusion. I don't have to go for successor. With that correctly matching peer, only I'm going to store the key value pair. Okay. So key is matching exactly with this peer with ID 15. So I'm going to store this key value pair directly within the peer with ID 15. So did you all understand now? So what is that I'm doing here? I'm storing just key value pair in these peers. Key value pair only I'm storing in these peers. Remember, so peer 10, sorry, peer 12, peer 15. These are the two peers which has these keys 11, 13, and 15. So remember, these are the peers which just stores this information. But the actual copy of CN, actual copy of your OS, and actual copy of your DBMS, actual copy, file copy of DBMS contents, actual CN copy, or actual OS copy, these contents, where is it stored? Those copies are stored in these IP addresses only. Don't forget that these IP addresses are the actual IP addresses which actually stores the copy of these files, OS, CN, and DBMS. But this key value pair to show you the route, to show you the path to reach this IP address, that is this key value pair, to store this key value pair, I'm choosing these peers. Okay, this peers with the closest ID here is chosen just to just to store this key value pair. So I don't want all the peers to store this all entire database. Instead, I'm choosing the peers there to store some of the key values pairs only. So the sum of the key value pairs are stored in some of the peers with closest ID. So now I will continue with this. How exactly the search becomes easier with this particular concept? How the search becomes easier with this newly explained concept? We will see now.